This video is sponsored by SyncTree. Can you build a backend with absolutely no code? When it comes to programming backend code, there's a lot to take into consideration. Databases, servers, reverse proxies, infrastructure, data modeling, programming languages, resources, shall I say more? For new programmers, this is extremely overwhelming with all of these technology stacks that you have to learn and maintain. For existing developers, there's lots of configuration and boilerplate for something that can easily be replicated. In this video, I'm going to attempt to create an email newsletter service similar to MailChimp or ConvertKit that can let me collect email addresses in a database and schedule random times to send an email. Now, if I was to do this any way I'd want, I would do this with my regular stack that I'm comfortable with, but we're challenging ourselves to do no code today. I've been challenged by SyncTree, more on them later, to try and build an application using their no code backend service. So let's try. To do this successfully, we're going to need 3 or 4 endpoints. Collect the email addresses with a first name. You don't want to be sending some sketchy emails with no first name. That's how it goes right to spam. 2 is to list those emails and names for me to see. This has to be protected though, because that's some really valuable information to me. 3, send the emails off at a scheduled time so that my subscribers can get an email that they have patiently or unpatiently been waiting for. And 4, send a report of the email sent or not so that I know exactly if I should fix something or not. Now, for extremely large services like ConvertKit, MailChimp, or SendGrid, their infrastructures are extremely massive and complex and have thousands of software engineers working at them. So my implementation's gonna be a bit simpler. I probably am not going to be a billionaire off of this, but I'll probably make my boss happy. For the no-code backend, I'm going to be using SyncTree by Ntuple. SyncTree lets you develop, deploy, and test your no-code-based applications all in one place. It comes with a giant suite of tools to develop APIs for applications in the cloud and takes advantage of the AWS technology and architecture without you having to manage your own VPSs or RDS databases. You create and manage your APIs by using the block editor where you can drag and drop things like strings, hash maps, variables, and other common programming terms in an easy color-coded way of visualizing it. I like this concept a lot because it builds a bridge between the technical people with the knowledge of all these terms and the less technical professionals who can easily view from a top-down perspective. You can also version control your API by putting them in branches like feature, dev, hotfix, staging, and production. Cool. The ability to test your endpoints in each branch is also available with the ability to add teammates with certain access control too, since we all know that one dev that breaks everything. SyncTree works on top of the AWS global infrastructure and technology so it's secure when building your APIs, as well as provides some compliance-related secure features like audit trails.
Ntuple is currently an AWS validated tech partner. Large financial companies such as AIG and ABL are already using SyncTree for application and backend construction.
So let's give this a try. First step. Let's see if we can set up a database to hold the users and first name. This is really going to be a simple database, so we could use a NoSQL or a SQL database. First, let's look into databases. I think for my project, I might just stick with a NoSQL database. That way I can iterate over my applications multiple times since this is a quick project that I'm building. I won't really benefit from a relationship model. Of course, if you see my backend developer roadmap video, I'll definitely tell the difference between the two. SyncTree lets me connect to an existing database, specifically DynamoDB in the cloud. It would be cool if SyncTree allowed you to provision a database with your API keys right from the application itself, but this is good for now. Deploying a database on AWS is simple. Let's just connect to it and we're good. Okay, let's tackle step 1. After creating an endpoint to use, let's start from scratch. Now, if you're familiar with how HTTP works or libraries that do this type of stuff, this will seem familiar, but might be complicated for those who aren't familiar. If I want to talk to a database, I send a request to a server. This request contains things like headers, a body, and other parameters. Sounds complicated, I know, but it's not. The response is what the server gives back depending on what you ask for, like data. It almost looks like Scratch, but for grown-ups. The editor is pretty intense and intimidating, but I just referenced some of the example projects and got an idea of how things were structured. Hash maps. I'm a JavaScript and Python pleb, so I'm a little less fancy. So as soon as someone sends their email and name to the API endpoint, let's connect to the database and insert it into the database. Then thank our lovely user for being so awesome. With these types of tools, they look awesome visually, but they do take time to get used to. For example, referencing a value you did in a previous step. Now I have it all set up and was easily able to add in the data into my DynamoDB table using the appropriate blocks. All right, step one over with. Not too bad. Step two. So I want to be able to list all the users I have. I'll create a new endpoint and have it set so that I can just query all of the data using the DynamoDB table. Now, that part wasn't really hard at all. Duh, I'm just able to grab everything. But if things are that simple, be skeptical. If I accidentally gave you this URL, well, you're toast. Well, I'm toast, more specifically. So I have to find a way to authorize that only myself can look at this.
SyncTree has this handy dandy feature called credentials. Now, the world of cryptography and authorization is an extremely large industry, and there's many ways you can go about this, depending on your scenario. For my purposes, I'm just gonna create a simple certification key that I'll rotate every month if I decide to continue with this incredible application. This just means that whenever I need to access something on my server, I just have to authenticate with that token that is provided. Now, to do this, I just have to go into my app and add it in the drop-down menu, kind of like a config file or something similar. This then gives me a block I can use called authorization. This is essentially like a function that will determine if you're verified or not. Similar to how you do it in programming, you just add your key in the header authorization, and then you use the authorization block to determine if it matches what's in your credential screen. This can make it pretty easy for you to gateway important things. Also, we don't even have to make a database call if someone sus is trying to access this. Now, for the rest of the endpoints that I'm going to be doing, I'm probably going to use this authorization block since it only requires me to do it.
All right, step two is over. Step three. Okay, so I'm going to use an API that I use for sending mail to send mail to all of our users. Email is something that is incredibly awful to deal with, so let's just pass this on to something that has dealt with this headache before.
We're going to use the SendGrid API to manage all of the emails in this case. Thank goodness for that. Since we're using an external API, this comes with some things that we need to take into consideration. Now, the first thing they'll teach you in any cybersecurity lesson is to never include keys of any sort in your code base. Funny enough, this also applies for no code base. No code base, is that a new term? We can use this feature called dictionaries that will expose the API keys through an environment variable. This keeps it away from our version control, and if someone can see a screen recording or something, they can't snag that key and get dangerous access.
We'll just create another API endpoint that accepts the authentication metric similar to the last step that we did. Imagine if someone got that URL and just sent someone some awful, awful email. We're also going to attach text onto the request to send to our users, aka the newsletter. Now, since this is going to be an awesome newsletter, we might as well write something interesting. Authentication is extremely necessary here since this will really annoy some of our users if someone grabs onto it and sends them some really mean things. Now, I just thought of a really good idea to make our app better. If I do a database call and then use the utility function that SyncTree has, I can probably get a count of all the users that the database provides me. Okay, so after doing this count and getting a list of all my users, I'll feed it into this pre-built HTTP request and we're good to go. I'll now just make an HTTP request back that will tell me if it was successful and then add a condition letting me know that if I'm a dummy or not. Looks like it works pretty well. Now I just gotta check all my emails to see if they sent. On to the next step, step four. One last little thing to make this a lot easier for me is to make a report from step three so I can look at a log of possible successes or failures of my email launch. So I'm gonna go back into my API endpoint and create a conditional that, if passed, save into my DynamoDB with a report saying it passed, the count of all the emails sent, and the timestamp. If I come back to this app, it might be pretty cool to add some sort of standard analytics dashboard on there, but I'm kind of getting a bit carried away, aren't I? Awesome. Now let's just make a quick API endpoint where I can get a list of these reports. Awesome. I can get a list of all the reports and can convert it into an Excel sheet if I really think I'm cool. Now, can you build some cool things with a no-code based tool? Absolutely. A lot of tools out there provide a template-based system that makes it hard for you to break out of the gates that they want you in. With tools like SyncTree, it's pretty easy to just create a small tool fast using terminology every programmer knows. Oh, and if you're using a legacy database at your business or at your job, I can see SyncTree being a really good tool for you to actually interact with that database without, you know, it crashing and dying. I do not want to touch old code, so let me just connect to it and move on. So the question, is no code going to replace programmers? Absolutely not. No-code tools, just like programming languages, are tools at the end of the day. If you're able to do everything you need using your favorite programming languages, chances are you will be more efficient in your code base anyway. No-code tools builds a bridge between the programming experience and building things really fast. So if you inherit a project that requires you to learn a brand new programming language or have to maintain a legacy project that you're too scared to touch, it's okay. I've been there. SyncTree and no-code might be the right project for you. Thank you, SyncTree, for sponsoring this video and challenging me to do this no-code challenge. What do you think about no-code tools? Let me know in the comments. Make sure you like, comment, and subscribe for more dev and technology content. Peace out, coders.